Okay, let's get started.
My name is Zhou.
Today, we talk about the deep learning platform, the evolving of deep learning platform with Knative. Be able to communicate with that
refrigerator
with this voice recognition. And all these rely on deep learning platform. Baidu has its internal deep learning platform, which is called Paddle Paddle. It is developed by Baidu independently. It's
It
offers trainings for data training, and it also offers model training, model evaluation, and model inference. Why do we need a platform rather than a framework for training? Because resource utilization is important. With this platform, we can improve the resource utilization. It also helps us to process with model pipeline and
like a
task platform. It offers multi-tenant and high security. It has business support as well, for example, research, advertisement, NLP, so on and so forth.
Why is our DLP
need Knative or Knative? Because first of all, the system is complicated.
In this complicated system,
there are many roles, many jobs involved, and all these need to incorporate it into a system. It involves data engineers who need to collect data
from
user end. They also need to collect, analyze, and store data.
After that,
data analysts need to train models, analyze, and evaluate models.
Then,
web engineers, like web engineers, they need to create the corresponding paths and provide corresponding services.
So it's a complicated process
that
involves
complicated technologies.
So how do we realize pipeline effectively?
And we found that Kubernetes
has
its advantage in terms of register publishing, image building, service deploying, load balancing, logging, monitoring, and scaling. It provides native support.
This is what we did before.
We can carry out job fault
tolerant. Or
P-server trainer and master. These are the different training units. They can be deployed.
Based
on this pedal operator, we can realize job fault tolerant.
And
later on, we introduce
Batch,
which was renamed Volcano. This project,
Kubernetes
provides the job interface, but this interface is not consistent with ours.
Like scalar
does its job based on pod.
But this can easily lead to
some failure. Therefore, we introduced the job level scheduling to deal with this issue. If you're interested, you can follow up on the Cool Batch or Volcano project. I'll come back to our topic today. Today, our focus is on serverless. Why serverless?
For
Kubernetes,
what is features
or its disadvantages?
It may have some disadvantages,
for its the maintenance is expensive. So they don't know about the resource they have. So if we create a cluster which became smaller, and when we need to scale up the cluster, there may be an issue if we lead to some resource waste. For the consistent extension, this is another challenge for them. And for Kubernetes, they also want to reduce resource waste. So the current framework is focused more on resource
And
this is a major concern for users as well. And users are concerned about the network bandwidth and container and the distribution of different network resources. And these are very complicated. Users just want to train their service and run their service. They don't need to. They don't want to be bothered by the network issues. And for security, traditionally, if you use namespace to isolate the containers, users would think that they wouldn't be able to distribute resources with a standard, with a unified container, unified cluster. This may present some challenges for them.
So
these are the issues. Why we choose serverless now? Because in the past we didn't choose serverless because there are some logic issues. First, it lacked safe container. And also, there's no security container, and also there in terms of container instance. Like in Kubernetes, if you set privilege to launch your container, there may be some bugs. For example, if you use this container with other users, and this container may be occupied by the other one. So, and also, container instance. That means I just need to the container instance provide a pod to match your service for elastic network interface, also called ENI. It helps us to address another issue. Like in the past, we thought the pod was a second-class IPG, but it cannot be communicated directly. But with the ENI, it helped to break down these geographic branches. So we can connect to pod IP more straightforward. And going forward, the new business management, like service mesh and serverless, with these new technologies, In our platform, we started to adopt new model. This is our current stack. There is no change, major change underlying at the bottom level. But for Kubernetes level, we have our resource API. Yesterday, during the keynote speech, they talk about the CRD, which is the first class.
It's
like the first class API. We thought that that kind of or low level API would be a pod, but with the CRD, then we can use all these services like Knative. They use CRD model to reorganize resources and deliver the features. So for the business, we started to use the serverless to support our business. And the upper level is the SaaS. For service, I will elaborate further. So why is now for now why do we need Knative? Knative is a kind of a serverless. You can find this on the official website. It says that Knative is a unified PaaS, FaaS, and serverless user experience. It has different features like automatic building of image, auto scaling, route management, better support in publishing. It also has this event driven. So when you use the Kubernetes or Knative, you will find that these are pluggable. The changes can take place step by step. This is also a picture from the website. It has three parts in terms of logic. First is build. So it provides templates such as Kit or Canonical framework. It is bound with Kubernetes service account. In terms of serving, it has auto scaling, scale to zero as well, because sometimes your applications doesn't require traffic or workloads. Then in that case, you can just scale your service to zero. It also offers routing based on Istio. It helps you to realize publishing. When it comes to eventing, it has decoupled pipelines. It supports third-party sources, such as GitHub. And it is cross-platform. And its service, such as AWS service, can be connected to the cloud. So these are the basic introduction of features of Knative. So why do we need Knative? First of all, in the past, we set out with a container runtime in 2012. There was the container runtime, and then in 2015, or around 2015, Knative take place and come into play. So you can see the changes don't happen overnight. It is a step-by-step process. So for the Knative, it addresses the issue of vendor lock-in.
And
some kind of serverless project available in market, we understand it all the time. This kind of project is not defined or have the standard API or the customer service. In the Knative, it is the Kubernetes ecosystem, and it also have the decouple process, and it is really easy to scaling. And all these are the three reasons that we chose the Knative. And I just introduced you that why we chose the Knative. And now I would like to introduce you that the three functions of the Knative and how we use all these three functions. And this is the old architecture. And it is the architecture, which is the default one. If you're interested, you can have a look at that. The right hand side is the build one. And the Knative one build is different from ours. What are the differences? You can understand that our build is outside of the Knative system, and we'll write all the code and we'll run the project individually, and we'll also write the scripts and run it on the machine. We don't use the Kubernetes to maintain it or not use it for the authentication. But this is the internal system, so we didn't have a really high requirement about that. And this is the Docker build, and also have kind of the strips, and also have the injects of the environment variables, and then we can process that. And this is an example of the new Knative build. You can have a look at the low part in the application. We can inject build Knative stuff back to generate a secret, and this secret can be bound to the service account above. In the build, we can use the service account name to bind our source as well as the image generated, and then it will generate it in the source and then image. But we found a problem for the Knative itself. To this kind of the format process, it's a little bit massive. So later, we try to use the tractor. And if you attend the meetings before, you will hear the project title pipeline. It is a new project, and in future, it will replace the main part of the Knative. And the architecture is really intuitive. On the right hand side, it uses the service account to for the authentication, and then your input will be defined, including the GitHub and other environments. And after several steps, you will have your own mirrored warehouse. And all these steps will be done in the Kubernetes clusters. And when we run it, you can bind to a model such as an NFS to share the storage, to go through all these kind of steps, which means that the build environment will be done entirely in the Kubernetes environment. So let's look at the build. We don't use the build very often because the functions are really simple. So now I would like to elaborate the Knative serving. So I would like to introduce you what is the Knative serving. Some of you may familiar with it, some may not. If you are familiar with that, you can have a look at the programs on the right hand side, and it will create a CRD. And in the CRD, there is a service definition which will be divided to the root and configuration. And later, I would like to introduce you the configuration to you later. But the root, you would like to realize some concepts of the serving, for example, the router of the network and the data control, as well as the strategy and the auto scaling. And if you are familiar with the Kubernetes, I would like to tell you that what kind of the resources changes that it will evolve. First, the combination and batch will be the self-defined or customized CRD. What is a trigger? It mainly trigger the deployment scheduled by the Kubernetes, as well as the HPA of the Kubernetes, which is the horizontal pod scaler, which is the horizontal pod scaler one. It is also one of the resources. It also can include the Kubernetes virtual service to create some router standards or the criteria.
And
just now, I just introduced you the configuration and route. So now, I would like to tell you what is the route and what is the configuration. And on the picture right-hand side, the configuration. It just defined a container. And also defined, well, actually it has already been missing. It can also define a lot of variables. And this kind of variable plus the mirror equals to a revision. Yes, that's right. Mirror plus the configuration equals to the revision. Any update of the mirror, any change of the configuration will generate a new revision, a new version. Let's have a look at the route. The purpose of the route is to introduce the data to the corresponding version. So all these are the functions of the route and the configuration. And you can see that 100% of data has already been directed to the mirror version. Now I would like to give you a deep dive of the service ingress. Is that when the data injected to and imported to the system, what would happen? And it is based on the activator. The activator will trigger, will activate a trigger. So it is highly reliant on the trigger to collect the data. And if you project can be scaled up, and the data can be imported to the corresponding part. On the right hand side, this kind of the architecture is not available in the Kubernetes. It's also an advantage of the native. You can use the native name and the percentage to define the data. For example, how many data will be imported to the revision 1 and how many data will be imported to the revision 2. And if you already know the path, you can also use the path to realize that as well. But for the native, it can provide a native support. The performance can be secured at the same time as well. And let's have a look at the ingress. The ingress also have other features. And all these are the tutorial functions. For example, the auto balancing and route based on header and the header adder. So let's have a look at the pattern model. It can release by using this kind of the native pattern. For example, we can publish to a small group of users and collect the feedback. And let's see that how we did the auto scale in the old way. Well, regarding to the auto scale and how we did in the past. In the past, we will provide a small version. We'll have 1 to 2 cases. I think that it is not really highly used in the clusters, and we'll add more cases and to make it reach a specific level and to allow the task can be run as soon as possible. And we, at the very beginning, we try it on the pattern operator. It was not universal, but in the Knative, it had already provided a better way. For example, it can realize the concurrence level, which is the API level visiting. If the concurrency reached 10 or over 10, the memory will be scaled to 100, but if the case is reduced and lower than 10, it will be reduced and scaled to 1. And actually, you can define your own auto scale system. For example, if you are really sensitive to some parameters, for example, the master number will be died, and the number of the died master will exceed a specific number, you can trigger this system and do the auto scaling. And later, we need to tackle one challenge, which is the cold start. It is also a problem of the Knative survey. In this solution, it also has some cases when it started, or some instance. But in our service, if there is no any data, it doesn't need any instance at all. So we introduced a cold start solution, but it has some problems, which is designed by the speed of the cold start, because that's when there's data and the system is not activated, and it will cause a delay of the service. And this challenge has not been tackled properly. Currently, we have several solutions. The first one is improve the ISTIL speed, and the second one is to reduce the image pool latency with the container. In this way, this kind of the image can be activated better. And there are some tactics, for example, immediately scaling up when the autoscaler gets started from the activator. In this way, we can, by using all these three solutions, we can deal with the problems related to the cold start. In our training clusters and how we did the training, in the past we have a large scale cluster, and then we will have different labels for different machines, and we also have the notability. For example, for the GPU, we'll have the label of the GPU, and we'll have the extended resources in the Kubernetes to add the tags. For example, if it is the 8 or the 41, we'll add all these kinds of concepts and the tags to the machines. In this way, we can schedule the service better. But in reality, we also use the GPU pack model to schedule or to compress it to use the resource better. For example, if we use the sprite model of the GPU, and the resources will be scattered in the Kubernetes environment. But in some tests, if it is the K40 or K8, and if it is run on the K16, there are some blanks, and some big jobs or the big tasks cannot be scheduled on this platform. And another one is the multi-tenancy. For our tenant, they are really sensitive to the safety. In the past, we only used the namespace to categorize them. Currently, in a new way, we have more choices. So what are our new choices? We have the unified resource pool to process all these kinds of problems. Well, actually, we haven't hit the limit, but I can elaborate that a little bit. We use the instance model. It has the additional resource pool. In this way, you don't need to define the extended resource or the label or node, that's as we did before. And after we add a machine, in the past, we need to check the configurations auto-way, in a manual way, but actually, we don't need to do it anymore. For example, when we add a new machine and the users require attending jobs, it needs two GPU, and we just deploy the two GPU in the resource pool. In this way, it doesn't have any fragments of the resource, and it can improve the efficiency of the or the utilization ratio of the resources. And when the users quit, the resource will be released. But in the past, if the user quit, it will cause the idling of the resources for a while. For example, here, and if there is an idle of the resources, it will waiting for the scheduling for a new project or new jobs. And now I would like to introduce you what we did on the edge. For the Knative and the edge, they can be combined together to schedule the resources. For example, in the edge and the upper level, we can add the original steps, and then the resources can be scheduling to the lower level by the Knative. In Knative service, when the resources was scheduled to the call controller, it will convert to the pod. And then we also done some converted by ourselves. We'll convert the resources to the pod and then schedule it. And it is a conversion of the resources. But for the network architect, we should use the previous one in the past in the CDN. When there is a breakdown, the KAN modules will still working normally.
Is to use the IP generated by the category and fix it. So even though it is still a centralized network, it has its stability. But for such a model, starting from cloud hub, the resources scheduled through pod, in pod fashion. Last but not least, I want to talk about Knative eventing. In the interest of time, I will give you a brief introduction. If you have learned about some event-based language, and you will know that they have a mailbox model. Through this mailbox, you can have communication. For Knative eventing, it is also follows such an approach. All the components communicate through loosely coupled event-driven system. It has the declarative binding. It is a declarative binding between event generators and event usage service. And after this declarative binding, then the services are bind and resources are communicated across. So I'll skip this. It also uses cloud events. Cloud events is like a protocol for language. Through these cloud events, then the operations can be done across platform, across services. Cloud events later will be further deployed or improved in our platform as well. Due to the time constraints, that would be my presentation. If you have any questions, feel free to raise your hand. So just now you mentioned the surfing. It seems like surfing is used mostly for inference. But what about training? Serverless is not applicable for training at the moment. In the past, we tried to use serverless for training, but we found that some models couldn't match our pattern operation because of the job tolerance, which couldn't be realized in serverless. And for resource pool, for the resource pool, is it local or remote? It's remote. Okay, thank you. Knative has a good advantage is that when I don't use it, I don't need to deploy the resource. So I would assume that in your case, users need to deploy the resource themselves, right? Let me rephrase your question first. You mean like when we use the resource, we need to define the resource, right? Well, I know that if you use Knative, we don't need to define the resource ourselves. Well, if you want to deploy resource well, I think you need to do it on your own. Like users, users have an idea about the resource for a pod. Let me see if I get your question right. You mean like we don't need to set the story, memory request or limit, right? Yes. To my knowledge, this is an advantage of Knative, right? In this community, we are working on this, and in the future, a vertical pod auto-scaling will be established. I'm not sure if you heard of it. It's about pod scaling, vertical scaling. It's not delivered, realized yet, but we are working on it. Like in the scenario, if you didn't think the pod is big enough for you, then you can scale it up vertically from 4 to 8 gigabytes, something like that. You mentioned about the GPO. Let me go back to this slide. This one, right?
Okay.
Like in the past, there is a GSA for, then you need to set a task, or there's a two card, and then that would be the fragmented resource. So here, it says the definition, like when you generate it, when it is generated, it is a gigabyte pod, then it will generate this pod. Like virtual one, virtual machine would be 8 gigabytes. So I mean is that it is a big pool and has a lot of resources in it. In this scenario, it's like a pool. Then this would be user cluster. And of course, we hope that this user cluster we hope that all users will choose resource pool over this user cluster. If the pool is used, and because it's isolated, like in you may deploy the resource isolation fashion, then you can apply for this 8 gigabyte instance. Well, physically, let's say we have 14, we have the 12 cards and yeah, that's the logic. With this user extends resource, it helps you to do this resource distribution better. Like it helps you to define with this namespace, and after user run it up, because there's a limit, then they couldn't apply more. And due to the security concerns, they couldn't use, there's no alternative for them to use. But now with this, in this new scenario, which is not realized yet or launched yet, it says here all the resources in the pool are available in a safe manner. Then there is no namespace limitation, and in a way the pool is infinite. So there, with this infinite pool, then there is no conflict, right? Yes, that's our hope. That's why we are working on it. Okay, last question.